you maintain the attitude. That's the only requirement. Satellite will be there in the space a long, long time, 50 years, 100 years, but it will not give you information. Now, there are many, many satellites right now around the Earth, and they measure all kinds of things. This measures the sea level height. This measures, again, sea level height. It measures gravity of the Earth, measures rainfall. This measures clouds, measures aerosol. So now we have a huge number of satellites. As a matter of fact, this measures ice. So as a matter of fact, the challenge many of us face today is there's too much data. You go to the website of any of NASA or any of these, data is pouring like anything, okay? The challenge is to how to handle the data coming in gigabytes and terabytes. So you have to know, the main challenge is not only to know which data to use, you must also know what are the limitations of data. The main problem today is, for all of you, there's all kinds of software available, all kinds of data available, but many of you don't know what the limitation of data in satellite is. To understand that, you must know how the satellite collects data. What are the basic principles behind it? Because sometimes you can misuse the data because you don't know its limitations. Okay? So the purpose of the lecture is to tell you the basic principles through which satellite converts what it measures to what you want to get, and what are the errors involved in that measurement, so that you don't use the data in a situation where it's not really valid. Yeah. No, you avoid that. No, you should not. For example, if your sensor is there to measure sun, it will be there with sunlight. Otherwise, you look, make sure it looks away from the sun. Suppose I have a sensor in the infrared, okay, to measure the sea surface temperature. It shouldn't be pointing at the sun, it will be destroyed. So it make sure you protect it. See, remember, most sensors of a satellite looks towards the Earth. So, okay, only one sensor which is measuring the solar energy will look up. So you ensure those sensors do not get sunlight into it because it will be too high a load on it. It will become too hot. See, there are various in the sensor design, which I will not have time to talk about. There are issues of temperature control because a sensor cannot become too cold because remember, space is a very cold place. It cannot get too hot. So you have to maintain sensor in a limited range. It is done by using various kind of, what do you call, reflectors, various kinds of protection. So you have to ensure, for example, suppose this is the satellite sensor, this is your bus, and you're mounting the sensor here. Now, this sensor should not see a part of the satellite. It will be a wrong answer. So you put a certain shield here to protect it. So you have to ensure that the sensor is having a field of view exactly the region you want to see and nothing else. There will be. Let's say, let me tell you that when you design a sensor, you calibrate it, okay? So this sensor, when it gives this kind of input voltage, what it is equivalent to this kind of, let's say, radiation. Now, when you put a sensor in space, after 1 or 2 years, it will get degraded. Okay? It is also hit by particles. So normal practice in scientific satellites is to have an internal calibration. Okay? For example, for sea surface temperature measurement, the sensor will look at the sea surface, then it will rotate and look at a standard source inside the satellite. Inside the satellite, there's a constant temperature source. So look at it, and that is a calibration technique. So you have to, if you want scientifically valuable data, then you have to ensure that your sensor is frequently checked for correctness. And this is especially true for climate change. Remember, climate change is a long-term change in something, right? So typically, suppose I want to know what is the change in sea surface temperature for the last 40 years. Okay, we have 40 years data. Now, one satellite won't give you that because one satellite may last 5 years. So you have 8 satellites data. Now, we have 8 satellite, 8 of them have 8 sensors. They are all designed same way, but they're not identical. So what you have to do is you have to make sure satellites overlap each other, and in the common time period when the two satellites are running, you have to intercalibrate. So a lot of work. It's a tedious work, but it has to be done. So now people have combined 8 satellites data by carefully looking at the overlap period, and if the sensor shows slightly different value, you adjust the values so that you have continuity of data. So this is a big challenge for climate change. For most of the time, satellites are used for weather forecasting. For that, you don't need calibration. Because if the cyclone is gone, I forget about the satellite. So that's what IMD was doing for a long time. But now, we are all using satellite for climate change understanding. For that, the demands are, you know, I'll give an example later. To measure the Earth radiation budget, which is very important for climate change, that satellite cost $100 million. That's about 500 crores. And why did it cost so much? Because each of the sensors had to be calibrated to give radiation accurate to 1 water meter square. That's not easy. Okay, a lot of work is required on the ground and in the satellite. And of course, you don't have time, but if you have time, you can go and have a look at, ISRO has a center called ISAC, and there are whole floors whose only job is to calibrate instruments. Very, a lot of work is done for calibration, because you have to do first calibration at the ground to make sure everything is right before it goes up. Once it goes up, you have to calibrate in the satellite. So both are done. Okay. So remember that just you put a sensor in satellite, you won't get good data. You have to work on it all the time, because sensors do degrade. Okay, that's why sensors are expensive. That's why it is expensive. Technically, it can be complicated. And the main point is that satellite does not measure exactly what you want. Okay? It measures either reflectivity or radiation or backscatter, and you want to convert this into something you want. And the major challenge is how you convert, and what are the principles used in conversion, and what is the accuracy of that conversion technique. So this is the whole spectrum of radiation one can use in a satellite, going from the visible. This is in meters, so visible is somewhere here. Okay. And all the way to microwave, radio waves, and so on. Entire wavelength is covered. And we'll see that each wavelength has advantage and disadvantage. General principle is very simple. If you choose low wavelength, that is high frequency. All of you remember simple way to remember this importance. High frequency means high energy. Because all of you know that the photon contains this much energy. Right? So if you go to the high frequency power spectrum, that is low wavelength, you get a lot of energy from that photon which strikes your satellite. So you will get very good sensitivity. So you can detect very small things if you want to detect. But remember that if you use visible power spectrum as your energy source, it's good. It's a lot of energy. But unfortunately, you won't get data during night. I want to measure C7 temperature at night. Of course, it's not possible. Then you have to move towards infrared. Infrared has a slightly lower value of frequency than visible, so less energy is available. So when less energy is available, either your sensor has to be more sensitive, or you have to average over a larger area. So when you do a satellite measurement, you have to make a decision over what area you want to average your data, and that depends on how sensitive your sensor is. So if sensor is not very sensitive and the energy coming is not enough, you increase the area in which you do the coverage. Now finally, people also use microwave. Microwave is very high wavelength, so very low frequency. So energy is very, very little. But microwave is still popular. Why is that? Because one of the major challenges we have in India is you want a lot of data about sea surface temperature and water vapor and things during monsoon. During monsoon, there's a big cloud cover over India. Right, today you can look at it, clouds are covering most of India. Now, cloud is covering the ocean and land, then you cannot see the surface in the visible or in the infrared. In both regions, clouds are completely covering the earth. The only way you can look at the earth's surface is through microwave. Microwave penetrates clouds very easily. Okay? But unfortunately, microwave has very little energy. H-nu is very, very low. Okay? About 1 millionth less than what you get in visible. So when you go to microwave, the only compromise you make is you average over larger area. So we'll see later on, whenever you have microwave data, the resolution is not very good. Typically, what we're getting these days is 10 by 10 kilometers. For visible, I can go, like what mentioned by Kiran Kumar yesterday, can go to 1 meter, half a meter. But you can't do that in microwave. Microwave will be in kilometers because it's got less energy. Okay, just a little history. First satellite for weather application, climate application, was launched in April 1960. That is 55 years ago. And the first geostationary satellite, which I'll talk about very soon, was launched only in 66, less than 50 years ago. Okay, and this has, of course, revolutionized weather forecasting and understanding Earth's climate. And so the last 50 years of data we have to look at. So the two main kinds of satellites launched in the last 50 years. One is geostationary, which is very high above the Earth. The other is polar orbiting, which is most common. Most satellites, 95% are of this kind. Typically, over 850 kilometers above the Earth. And this is much, much higher. Now, why is this much higher? Because in a geostationary satellite, you want the satellite to rotate around the Earth at the same rate as the Earth is rotating. By doing that, you ensure that satellite remains stationary with reference to a point on Earth, right? If the satellite is over Bangalore and is going around the Earth once in 24 hours, then you'll see Bangalore and nothing else. So to ensure that, you have to go to this altitude. Let me just show you how that is done. That's purely from simple Kepler's laws. So this is the geostationary orbit. Around the equator it goes. The equator of the Earth and going around at this altitude. Why this altitude can easily be explained by a simple formula. And for that formula, I'm going to assume the Earth is a sphere. Earth is not exactly a sphere. You can see there's a slight difference in the radius at the equator and in the pole, but that will small difference, you ignore it. If you ignore and take Earth as a sphere, then you can calculate from Kepler's laws that the period of the satellite is proportional to the gravitational constant, mass of the Earth, the distance between the satellite and the center of the Earth, and you can calculate this quantity, okay? And this example is given here. If you, the satellite is at the height of 360 kilometers above the Earth, so the Earth's radius, you can calculate this. It will have a typical 91 minutes, typical polar orbiting satellite, about 90 minutes. So a typical satellite which goes around 500 to 800 kilometers above the Earth will have a 90-minute orbit. Okay, that's very common. If you want 24-hour orbit, you have to take the thing much higher. And all of you can calculate this. You put here in your 360, 36,000 kilometers, at once they will become 24 hours. All of you can check this very easily. Okay, this is a comparison between geostationary and polar orbiting. Okay, now remember that geostationary satellite has to be along the equatorial plane. So you can imagine that now every country in the world which has got some interest around the equator have got their satellites. So there's lack of space here. There's only one plane in which you have put satellites. So now there's the international law. It determines who will put a satellite because there's not enough space. But polar orbiting, no problem. You can put any angle here. Huge coverage is there. You have a lot of space to maneuver here. Here you have no space to maneuver. So by law, India has a right to put satellites between, I think, 70 east and 100 east. And then China and Japan take over 100 to around 150. Then America, being a big country with huge, this one goes on from whole of Pacific and America and Atlantic. And the Europeans control that Atlantic to 70. So the whole world is divided into six or seven zones. Each country is given, and Japan also covers that side. Each country is given a certain space. And that's all. So that's how it is done. Yeah, this example of satellite here, inside is not mentioned here somehow. So around the equator, these are the American satellites around Pacific, the European satellite around Africa, inside should be here. Then this is the Japanese satellite, and one of inside is here. And this is the Japanese satellite GMS here, and there's a Chinese satellite here. So all these are covering the equatorial plane. Now, typical polarizing satellite, one advantage of polarizing satellite is that the geostationary satellite is very good for looking at a point continuously, cyclone tracking and so on, but it cannot look at the poles. You can calculate the distance of the satellite is 36,000 kilometers from the center of the Earth. You draw a tangent, it will not go much beyond some 50, it will not cover this region. Okay? So polar is not covered. So if you want global coverage, you have no choice but to go polar orbiting. There's no choice. Okay? So most satellites are polar orbiting because a typical polar orbiting satellite will cover most of the Earth in 24 hours. Because it takes 90 minutes to one round, in the meantime Earth is rotating. Satellite will cover different part of the Earth in the next 90 minutes and goes on like this for 17, 18 orbits and will cover most of the Earth. So that is the, so these are the most popular satellites. And secondly, of course, you must remember energy required. The energy required to launch a satellite into geostationary is very large because you have to go to that MGH, that height where to go. Polar orbiting costs much less because it's only 800 kilometers. So most satellites are polar orbiting. A few are geostationary. Yeah, this example of one of the satellites Americans launched earliest. So it has a visible resolution of 1 kilometer, which is very good for studying clouds. Infrared has less energy, so a little more area is required, 4 kilometers. And I'll talk about this later, sounder. So these two are the typical image sizes we get from geostationary satellite. But if the same sensor is put in a polar orbiting satellite, you can get even finer resolution because you are nearer to the Earth. So here he has got both 1 kilometer. You can actually go, can go below 1 kilometer. Infrared comes to 1 kilometer, but today even less is possible. You get 500 meters, 200 meters, and so on for measuring sea surface temperature. Okay, so this is the typical track. So satellite is moving like this. You look at the point right at the bottom, that's called the nadir. The nadir track is shown here for geostationary and, sorry, geostationary you're showing the field of view, and for polar orbiting you're showing the nadir track. So you can see it starts here, goes many, many rounds, and ends up finally here. So it covers the entire Earth in many, many orbits. Now, this is what is shown here, the line is the nadir point, and remember that the when the satellite is going like this, if you want to cover all portions, you have a scanner which moves like this. So if you move like this, you cover a certain portion. So depending on how far you move to the right and left of this nadir point, you get a coverage like that. So I'll show that in the next slide. Yeah, this is a comparison between two satellites. This is polar orbiting, and this is TRIM, Tropical Rainfall Measurement Mission. The TRIM's main aim was to study rainfall in the tropics. So they decided to reduce the inclination. It was not polar orbiting because in the poles it doesn't rain much. So the inclination was 35 degrees. So that satellite only went up to 35, 40 degrees. Well, the polar orbiting goes up to the poles. Okay. But notice that the TRIM satellite covers the tropics much better than the polar orbiting satellite because it is most of the time only in the tropics. So there's a comparison between two kinds of satellite tracks here. And this is Megatropics, which was launched 3 years ago. And here is Bangalore, one ground station. The other is Kororo, the French station. And it was launched at 20 degrees. Again, it covers only tropics, 20 to 20. And you must remember that satellite, when it is going around the Earth, is gathering data. Now, that data has been downloaded. So you need a ground station. So there are two ground stations here. That means 90 minutes you're collecting data. So every 45 minutes you download here and here, roughly, two places. Or then download all the data in both places. And there are a lot of technologies involved here. Remember, the satellite is going over, in the case of here, not Bangalore, but Hassan. Hassan is the tracking station for ISRO. It will go over that place only in a few seconds. So you must have a very special way to rapidly download data of 90 minutes in a few seconds. That's a challenge. Quickly you have to download all the data in a short period when it goes over Hassan, because the time will take only a few minutes to cross that region. So this is one of the challenges in satellite data. Remember that today with very special instruments available, I can get a lot of data. But that data has to be downloaded to the ground in a short period of satellite goes over the ground station. So that limits how much data you can gather. That is the biggest problem. If you are very particular, in some satellite, what they do is, they as the satellite collects data, it's put on a tape inside the satellite, and then slowly it is downloaded to the ground in many, many rounds. That also can be done. But you must remember that there are constraints on how much data you can transmit. Okay, this is a view of 7 days of orbit of megatropics. And you can see it only covers part of India and this one, because we want to understand the role played by clouds in the tropics. So our focus was mainly this region and not this other. This is a 3D view of the same thing. Okay, so this gives you the various regions used in satellite, visible region, infrared, and microwave, and various bands in the microwave. And the key point to be remember is that Earth is fairly opaque in the infrared, fairly transparent in the visible, and in the microwave. So if you want to study the Earth's surface, then you have to stick to visible or microwave, or a small region here around 10 micron, which is transparent, it's called the window. There's one window here, another window here, a big window here, and a large window here. So these are the windows through which you can look at the Earth's surface. So you can ask, what is the use of this region, which is completely opaque? This region is useful if you want to study the atmosphere, because in this region, atmosphere absorbs Earth's radiation and re-emits it to the satellite. So satellite can only find out what's happening in the atmosphere, not the surface. So that's also useful. Remember that satellite is not only used for Earth's surface. That is also used for studying atmospheric temperature profile, humidity profile, profile of carbon dioxide, amount of methane, amount of ozone. All these you want to measure, then you will use the absorption bands of water vapor, of ozone, of carbon dioxide. So if you want to measure the amount of a gas, then you have to look at absorption bands. If you want to look at the Earth's surface, you look at the windows. Okay? So that's the difference between these various channels. This is a typical view of a full orbiting satellite for 1 day. What you must remember is that this is called a swap. This is the nadir as the satellite moves, and it scans this way. So it moves this distance. Now in this satellite's case, this is Terra, the movement are such that the next pass of satellite and this part, you don't overlap. It's like gap. You lose information there. There's no choice. Okay? So you might say, why not increase the angular movement of the scanner? The problem is, as you go to larger and larger angles, this I can best show. Unfortunately, this is not working. I don't know why it's not working. All you can imagine, take your any light source, put it right on the nadir point, it'll be a circle, right? As you move away, it becomes an ellipse. As you move very far, the ellipse gets distorted, and the data you get is not very reliable. So you cannot go beyond 50, 60 degrees. If you go beyond that, the data you're getting is highly distorted data. So most people restrict the scanning this way to around plus or minus 60. So that is the limit. And that is, and R is the high edge height of satellite. So H into this theta is what is the maximum you can go. So they have done that here, and the slight gaps are there, which is missing data. Here's an example of TRIM coverage. This is 1 day and 2 days. You can see in 1 day, TRIM does not cover all parts of the Earth. There's a gap. But you go over 2 days, it covers all parts of the earth. So typically trim is used not for daily data, but for average over 2 or 3 days, it is safer. The other satellite, this is, in polar orbiting satellite, there are two kinds. One is sun synchronous, and other is not. What is sun synchronous? You make sure that your orbit around the Earth is an integral multiple of 24. Now, why is that? For certain applications, like ocean color monitor, you want to look at the same spot every day at the same sun angle. Because sun angle determines how much it is reflected from the ocean. So the ocean color is very important. You want to know where the phytoplankton are, where are the fish going to be. So you want to know where the ocean really producing a lot of photosynthesis. So for that, you look at the ocean, the visible region. And in the visible region, you look at the ocean with sun coming at a certain angle, let's say 9 a.m. So today you look at 9 a.m., tomorrow also should be 9 a.m. so that you get the correct picture. Tomorrow is 11 a.m., you get a different reflectivity. So these satellites are so arranged such that they go around the Earth, let's say every 1 hour or every 2 hours, so that when you divide that by 24, you get an integer. So that means I'll make sure it comes back next day at the same time. Today it's 6 a.m., tomorrow also 6 a.m. If you don't make it an integral multiple, if you make it some odd number, then it will come today 6 a.m., tomorrow 7 a.m., day after 8 a.m. So then it's no good. So this is very easy to arrange when you launch a satellite. When you launch a satellite, you adjust the altitude such that its orbit around the Earth is a round number divisible by 24. Okay. That's what you do. Okay. But this satellite has also lots of gaps, you can see. This is a microwave satellite, SMMR. Okay, so this is an example of the scanning. So the nadir point scans this way. If it scans right at the nadir point, it will be like a rectangle here, slightly at a different angle, so it is slight arc is there, you can see that. So this is how satellite is moving, and it is scanning this way. But scanners are a problem. History of satellite technology has been, the scanner has a moving part, okay? And in the conditions of space, it's very cold there and harsh, the scanner can fail. So as a matter of fact, megatropics on a scanner fail. So generally, if you want reliability in a satellite, you should not have moving part. So what can we do? Unfortunately, if you want to cover a lot of ground, you need scanner. But today, there is a revolution. All of you have a mobile phone with you, and it contains what is known as CCD, charge coupled device, which was mentioned yesterday by Anil Kulkarni. Now that's a small, nice electronic sensor, and that's very inexpensive now. So what you do today in satellite is, instead of scanning, you put lots of these CCDs along the line here, okay? And then you move this way, that's all. No scanning. This is a beautiful solution. So this will work forever, as long as satellite is there. No moving part. So you have small sensors arranged all like that. But you can imagine all this is a very elegant solution. There's a problem. You have to make sure that this CCD and this CCD has the same sensitivity. You have to calibrate it. Because there are so many of these sensors now, let's say 100 of them or 50 of them, all the 50 had to be identical. So there's a lot of lab work to make sure that they're identical. So a lot of money is spent in space application. You'll make maybe 10,000 pieces and you'll select only 100 because they have to be identical, right? So that is the challenge here. There are, in this scanner, there's only one sensor and you're scanning. So no problem calibrating. Same sensor is seeing all parts. Here, there are 100 pieces and it is moving this way, very nice, but you have to make sure that all these are giving the same response. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. That is true. At nadir level, the best resolution, as you go away, it will get more and more distorted. So what you generally do is, at nadir you get the nice little circle, okay? Now as you move away, it becomes ellipse. Now, what you decide is, you make a decision, let's say this is, just for argument, let's say this is 1 by 1 kilometer here. There it is 4 by 1 kilometer. And you want uniform result. Then you make a compromise. You say, I will make all the data 2 by 2 kilometers. So you give 2 by 2 kilometers here, there you'll have 4 kilometers. You have to somehow overlap two of the images to get a, you have to do some averaging there. So always near the end there'll be a problem. So, reassign. What you do is, here you have 1 by 1 kilometer, right? And as you go away, it becomes larger and larger. But the user wants data in a uniform grid, right? So you average it such that 2 by 2, you get lots of data. But near the end, you won't get 2 by 2. You have to make some assumption and approximation to interpolate from 4 by 1 to 2 by 2. You have to do some little careful thing you have to do. So at the end, always there's a problem. So generally, we avoid, I try to stick to plus or minus 30. That's very safe. But if you go to 60, problems will come. Yes, CCD is very good. No, everywhere everything is same. But then you have to worry about all giving the same data. Yes, CCD is much better. Yeah, this is called the push broom scanner. So it's moving this way along track. Not this is called cross track scanning. This is along track scanning. So if you have a CCD camera and you push it like that, then you're covering a rectangular space with no problem. Yeah. Yeah, could be, but I tell you the general experience in last 50 years space technology is avoid moving parts. So you want a moving sensor at the end, it may fail sometimes. Why do you want to take the risk? See, I tell you why you is, if you're so particular about not having gap, you make a longer sensor, that's all. What's the problem? Yeah, that's because these are old satellites. In a new design, what you will do is, if you decide you don't want to miss any point, the length of this should be such that the next pass will overlap with this one. You can design it. At the design stage, you make sure the length of your push room is such that the next pass which comes here will have at least 1 or 2 CCD overlapping. We have to do that in the design stage. Yes. Or interpolate. What happens is, you have data here, data here, then you interpolate. It's interpolation, not extrapolation. So what's happening, I tell you, in the old days, people were happy with whatever data came. Now the user community is getting more and more demanding. So people are getting more and more fancy, and there are no more, I don't think any new satellites have any gaps. Gaps have been pretty much removed now. Because people won't tolerate it, but they want data everywhere. Yeah, just giving you an example before I go into more detail. This is an example of how using both microwave and radar, people have been able to monitor the movement of ice, which is a major theme of this course. So this is possible today because ice and water have very different properties, both in the visible and in the microwave. In both these regions, ice and water have very different properties, so you can exploit the difference dramatically. And people have been watching, and one advantage of ice, remember, it moves very slowly. So data once a day is more than enough. While clouds is very difficult. Clouds in megatropics, they were very particular about data every few hours, because clouds last only at the most 1 hour, typical cloud. So if you want to understand clouds, you have to have very frequent sampling. But ice is safe. It's a very slow moving stuff. You can get data every week or even someday every month for a glacier. So a lot of good data has been obtained from microwave sensors in the last 40 years. And for example, what you saw yesterday in my talk of the decline in Arctic sea ice from 21,000 to 8,000 was all done by microwave satellites. They go over the poles every time. You know exactly where the ice line is. You mark it, and next time you go, you mark it, and you get a very good idea about how it's moved. Here was the famous example 13 years ago when the Antarctic Larsen shelf collapsed. Okay, this was seen by satellite. When it started collapsing, it was seen very clearly because satellite was over it when it happened. Now, one of the challenges in satellite remote sensing is to differentiate between cloud and ice. It's very tough. And I think Anil or somebody will cover that part because clouds reflect radiation, it's visible, so does ice, so does snow. Snow, ice, cloud, they are very similar in characteristics. So you do a lot of careful analysis to separate out this. Here you can see roughly that there is fog here and there is ice here. And you have to differentiate between fog and ice. I think here the fog is a little darker than ice, I believe. But sometimes they can be same color. Then you have to use some other region. This is fog, darker one, and ice is this. Huh? No, this is not microwave. This is visible. I'm talking visible here. Let me tell you what channel it is. NOVA 12, so this is visible. Yeah, microwave will penetrate the cloud. Yes, microwave, no problem. You'll see this one. But microwave limitation is you do not get high resolution data. If you want high resolution, you have to be invisible or IR. Yeah, microwave will go through cloud, no problem. If you have large glaciers, microwave is the best. Yeah, so here is a clear distinction between water and ice, which we have to make. If you have a cloud, you want to know whether it contains ice or water, you have to know that the refractive index, let me write down, the refractive index determines what happens to the N has two parts, real part, which all of you know about. This determines how it reflects, this determines how it absorbs and emits. So this is absorption and hence emission. This determines reflection. Okay. So look at the imaginary part of water and ice vapor index. You see, they are very similar in most places. Very similar, okay? A few spots, they are slightly different. And you have to exploit. So this 11 to 13 micron, will be talked about in this course later. There's a clear distinction between ice and water. And so is true around 6 micron and around 3 micron. So these are the places you put your sensor to differentiate between ice and water. So, suppose you want to know ice cloud or water cloud, you use those wavelengths. Yeah, the other thing you are using very often in the microwave is to differentiate different land types based on their emissivity. Okay, at nadir. This is the frequency in gigahertz. You can see that microwave is very useful to differentiate between ice, dry snow, refrozen snow. All these can be differentiated because they are slightly different emissivity at some frequencies, and this is wetland. So you can choose the right frequency to differentiate between wetland and seawater, or between dry snow and refrozen snow. So these are information you require to be able to identify what kind of landform you have. Here's an example of the global land emissivity product from the 13 gigahertz channel of SSMI. And you can see clearly that areas which have snow have a much lower emissivity than areas which have water.
enough for some of you. Okay, all right. Okay, then I think I should talk for another at least half an hour or 1 hour. Nothing new in this lecture. Not a single slide is new. It's all, I have spoke about it. But slides are same, but ideas are different. I will talk about in which direction glaciology should go in future. What are the national needs? And how we can bridge this gap with the development of science. That is the idea of this talk. And most of this talk, not all of this talk, but most of this talk was given by me to the Pope in Vatican. So it is because at that time I started to think differently, that was the theme given to me was glaciers as a source of water, the Himalayas. But idea was that is where our contemporary understanding of geology is and which direction we need to go in future to meet the gap. That was the idea of that talk, and I continue to develop on those ideas indifferently. You already seen this slide, and you know that where are the glaciers located, and along these mountain ranges, and numerous rivers originate, Brahmaputra, Ganga, and Indus into this region. There are numerous tributaries also contribute water into the major stream. And the snow and glacier melts during summertime and makes them perennial. And that has helped to sustain Indian civilization for thousands of years. So, and millions of people depend on the water supply, so it is important for us. We already know that this is very important for us as far as amount of water which is coming from these glaciers into overall stream runoff of Indo-Gangetic plains. So it is varying from 10% to almost 60-70% in Indus Basin. It's 60% in Ganga and maybe 70% in Indus. So it is varying from 10% to 70% depending upon which part of Ganga Basin you are located or which part of Indo-Gangetic plain you are located in. And it is also important for us that our food security of nation depends on it. Because we produce most of our food grain on the plains of North India. And it's almost, in India, it's almost more than 60% we produce, including Punjab and Western UP and up to the Bengal. And in Pakistan produces about 96%. Why every time I mention Pakistan? Because it's not only our national security may not be threatened only by military action of Pakistan, but if there's a collapse of water availability and food production in Pakistan, our national security will be also significantly affected because of that. And nation has to prepare for millions and millions of climate refugees. So these are the future challenges. And how now we strategically design our program so that we as a scientific community can provide necessary inputs to the politicians so that they can be helped to meet these future challenges. That is the theme and that is the idea of this presentation. And just look at it. The first comes in your mind that how much is the extent in glacier and where they are located. So key problem, so it is in Himalaya it is 40,000, and in India it is around 23,000 square kilometers region we are getting. And if you really look into the major challenges, if at all we want to apply any model and do any future work, we need to convert that into the volume. And that is how we need to take up our new study. If you really look into this, the estimates of glacial store water is varying very significantly in the Himalayas. You had 12,000 gigatons. A couple of years back, we thought it is 12,000 gigatons. And latest thinking is somewhere about 2,000 gigatons in the glacier. So now, first thing to do is bring higher level science to remove this uncertainty. Remember, it is fine for us to work, take the ground penetrating radar, go to one or two glacier, get the depth and write a nice scientific paper. But it is another matter, if I want to know 9,000 glaciers depth, and I want to know spatial distribution of depth. So that is where new efforts and new science has to go. And you have done this exercise about depth estimation, and there are different methods give you different depth. And over a period of time, last 10, 15 years, particularly after 2007 IPCC report, people have tried to do many things in different methods and the estimates are. So that is a key area where, in my opinion, research has to go. And maybe we will revisit that story again. Another key problem which we need to do is, whatever is doable should be done correctly. And what is doable? The one thing is doable is measure the retreat of glaciers. What you conclude from that is another matter. We can apply different principles and conclude differently, but our basic data should not be erroneous. And so one of the key things is, because it creates the huge confusion in the mind of people, and then if scientific community cannot build consensus on any issue, politicians are never going to believe it. And what has happened lately is there is a lot of mediocre science enter into mainstream and created problems. Like, for example, I give you, some people have used medium resolution satellite data, which is at the interval of, I was talking about that earlier, and they have estimated retreat of glaciers. So you have a satellite data with spatial resolution is around 30 meters, and you require generally 3 pixels to identify snout correctly and assess its retreat. That means it's 90 meters approximately. And if glaciers are retreating around 10 meters per year, if they are excessively debris covered, it could be smaller than that. Mean retreat of glacier in Himalaya is around 10 meters. So for 10 years, if you have any data with the time interval less than 10 years, on satellite images, it appears like a stationary glacier. And unfortunately, many people concluded that Himalayan glaciers in the last 10 years are not at all retreating. So that has added a complexity. So here it is 15 meters, so 10 meters, depending upon if debris cover, it is lower. So that has added complexity into what consensus we can build, and how we can put our case to the political leadership. So we need to do, that is why my idea of giving you training, or every year I give training, because to communicate this mistakes, some of us do unknowingly. But it has a larger implication, the way eventually, because if you have a 10 paper which comes out with this understanding, or without having this understanding, argue that glaciers are not retreating, it is a very difficult to say that, make another case where you can say that it is indeed there, whether it's retreating or not. It becomes a tough. And you are arguing on the issues which are not important, but some other issues are anyway getting sidetracked because of that. So that's why I want you to really do this issue very clearly. Of course, we can use satellite data to estimate the retreat or this loss in area also, and we already know. So these are two observations which we can do very easily, and we can do it correctly, and then we should interpret it correctly. If all of you understood this, its dimension, then it should not be too difficult. Another key problem which has really affected, because from 2007 onward, is mass balance. Many of us, because mass balance by any standard is a very major enterprise for anybody, because you don't need to go to field, not only us, twice. You require a supply chain to provide you food and provide you security. And a lot of people has to stay on glaciers, track on the glacier, collect the data, and you are spending lakhs and lakhs of rupees doing that. And if glaciers are too large, it will be too difficult for you to have a number of stakes and do the work. So it brings us the two problems. One problem is, due to our nature and our difficulty, we tend to select glaciers where we can easily go. We are not going to select glaciers where it may be representative, but it is 3 or 4 days tracking from roadhead. And you don't want to track that much. You say, okay, I can go by the evening and reach the base camp, and then next day I can go to glacier. Or I'm going to select a glacier which is a small in size so that I can really put 5-6 stakes and 1 or 2 pits and get the representative mass balance and my work and PhD done. But that is not what representative of Himalaya is. So we need to look differently to the problem that all of us are going to do work which is humanly possible for us. We are not Superman or Superwoman. We are going to do whatever is physically possible for us to do. But the beauty of science comes is how we can upscale it. And that is what precisely not happening right now. Many of you are here working in glaciological program. All of you are thinking how we can have automatic weather station. How I can use the lapse rate, how I can get the mass balance. We are not thinking differently than that. So probably we need to look at this issue very differently, because one of the key things we want to know is, it's wonderful to have a one glacier mass balance, but I want to know how much mass is lost from a basin. If I have a basin where I want, and if there is a huge hydropower station is there, or if there is agriculture is there, and how it is losing, we want to know that kind of assessment. So we required a multi-scale approach to this problem. That you can do it for one glacier by using glaciology, classical method, but you need to upscale it. Upscale it by using some other method, probably geodetic method. Some of you, all of you are using ELA and AR method. It gives me pleasure when you do that, but not necessarily it's very ideal without, because some of you might have understood the difficulties of that. And it's quite possible that you come up with the erroneous result if your understanding about the physical basis of ELA is not very clear. So key thing I feel right now we need to do is upscale it. Upscale in such a fashion that we start getting mass balance estimate for basis wise. And how to plug in our 1 year, 2 year, 3 years data for long-term changes. So that is one of the key things, in my opinion, is completely lacking. I'm struggling last couple of years to develop program on that, but still it is not heading anywhere. Another problem is, many of us, we do work, is on how precipitation and temperatures are changing. It's one of the difficulty which I feel is not properly addressed. All analysis is, and every time you see the data, we have slightly inflated temperature changes in Himalaya compared to other parts of India. There could be perfectly scientific reason, but we are not properly accounting land use changes surrounding the observatory. It's my take. I may be wrong. I'm not saying whatever I'm going to say is correct. But that is where we need to relook. Like, if we take temperature out of this IISC, and around that, now 50 years back, it was pristine land, and today everything is constructed. So obviously temperatures are going to go up because of this land use temperature. But when you want to convert that into a climate change reason, rather than attributing to the regional climate changes, so our desire to explain all changes are due to the global climate change rather than regional climate change. So we need to address issue about regional changes also very aggressively in our analysis. Okay, this is, so now next issue is about how we are going to address problem related to the formation of lake and possible flash flood from it. We all are, we know that day by day disaster in mountains are increasing, and there's a need to look at this issue more systematically and more comprehensive way. Remote sensing provides us opportunity to look at the data, satellite data, and estimate formation and dewatering of lakes into the mountains. But same time, this data is completely fragmented. We are, and there's no systematic program by which we can do this, not only monitoring, but eventually have a mitigation strategy for resolving this problem. And many of these things can be done by remote sensing. Many of these things requires very detailed field investigation. So what we need to do now is to evolve another major program where all issues related to the formation of lake and how that is going to create the disaster in downstream. But also important for us to know is formation of lakes are not only going to affect floods in downstream, but it has a significant potential to address or affect retreat of glacier. Why is that? Because if you see all these images, see, look at these images. These images are nothing but glacier which is covered by debris. So what happens is, as more and more debris push down the region, the accumulation of more debris takes place near the terminus. And as you come backward from this terminus, the amount of debris covers are relatively less. And then what will happen? That means if more is the debris cover, it retards the melt of melting. So now you have a position where there are differential melting rate takes place. That means this region has a less melting and this region has a more retreat. Like this region has less, this what it will do over a period of time. Now this is a glacier. Now, this is a glacier. Here now is a terminus. This region is melting less now, and this region is melting more. Then what it will happen is, slope will start changing. So eventually, this can become a reversal of slope. And what it will do? If there's a reversal of flow, then water flow will be obstructed and start forming these lakes. And when these lakes are formed over a period of time, they will stabilize and eventually this will become very large lakes like this, or it will be like this. And the moment this large lake is formed, the interface between this ice and water, there will be a lot of wave action, there will be a lot of latent heat transfer from water to ice, and the amount value. So now this is the your amount of retreat of glaciers, not only defined by climate change, but it is defined by morphological changes in the region. Correct? So, and this rate of retreat could be substantially higher than otherwise this would have. So earlier thinking, what I'm trying to argue to is, earlier thinking that if there are debris cover, rate of retreat will be reduced. Not necessarily true. Because now new process has taken over. And that new process is formation of lakes. So we have to be, there's only one we have understood, not necessarily this will be last. There might be many things happening in mountain. So we require a continuous monitoring of new processes which are going to take place. And not necessarily leading to the part of global climate change, but as they call is in global climate change, a feedback. So this is a feedback due to one balance start reducing, what it will do with the glacier, this is one possibility. So we need to understand this as well as many other processes which are going to take place. So continuous and intelligent monitoring of glacier and that region is important. And it is not only the lake formation is a new process takes place. There could be others also. And one of which international community is very active is effect of black carbon on change in albedo. That is a major investigation. But our understanding is extremely limited in this field. And obviously because we do not have enough human resources to address this problem. Because this problem is different than otherwise any earth scientist can handle. I mean earth science, it means geology, geography, civil engineering, those who are working in Glacier. What it means is, it's quite possible because of our burning of the biofuel and numerous other things, black carbon or vehicle transport, whatever it may be, black carbon is transport generated and it migrated upward into the atmosphere. Yesterday you have seen that it's more in upper atmosphere and it can get transported into glacier and deposited. If it gets deposited, it has potential to affect the glacial albedo and eventually lead towards the lower mass balance and then lead towards the retreat of glacier. But our understanding is reasonably incomplete, essentially because if we want to employ satellite images, there is a complex issue because the change in albedo is not only caused because of black carbon, but because, as I was saying yesterday, because of the mineral dust, liquid water, grain size, depth of snow, and a whole lot of issues. Solar zenith angle, all kinds of issues are there. So we required very complex model to understand influence of each of these parameters. And top of that, we need to do it quite often because its effect is not permanent in nature. Its variability throughout season or that is very large. So how much it continues, so we can't do it physically. We can go one or two places, measure and study it, but we need to employ modern techniques or new satellites to do it. So it will require solving radiation transfer theories, and strong academic program is needed to address this issue at first place, and second place is strong observation program, which is completely lacking. But it's not necessary that black carbon is only affecting albedo. There is mineral dust, there are other issues that are also affecting. So what we lack is a very decent program and strong scientific group who can take this challenge for future work. Because these are two in combination, that one is Moraine Dam Lake and these are the regional processes. These are related with the local regional issues, not necessarily global issue. So we have to understand thoroughly, and in this direction, we need to go into the future to understand. Another key difficulty is how we will know that in future how much stream runoff will change and when. Remember one thing, that response of climate change and the impact of climate change on glacier varies from region to region, basin to basin. It is not uniform. And if it is not uniform, there will be huge time gap between some regions are affected and another regions are affected. We have seen that in some of my presentations, and maybe there are a couple of more slides down the line which will show you that. So we need now a major modeling program where we can combine our knowledge about glacier inventory, glacier mass balance, glacier dynamics, flow equation, then future changes in climate change, all those things, to develop a model where we can come up with what is next 50 years going to happen to Parvati Basin, what next 50 years going to happen in different basins, which are going to respond very differently. So it's completely lacking right now. Right now that is nobody is thinking beyond obvious, and you know this slide also you have seen how it is going to affect. So this is another major area of investigation in my opinion, and we do not have enough people to do this work, because this work is required complete understanding of glaciology. It means you should understand glacial inventory, glacial dynamics, glacial mass balance, interaction with atmosphere, with ice, and climate models, and hydrology, runoff modeling. So it is, we required a dedicated group to work in that direction. And that is something which is, in my opinion, we need to take very urgently, and we need to do it. And this we have seen. This also you have, in a context I talk about it, because there are some models now started, there are still a lot of issues on those models, and modeling effort never gets completed, unless somebody types and say he gave up. So it's a continuous process, and we still need to do it. Where we get the special distribution, I know where in the future these lakes will be formed, and make an assessment about future history. So there are new ideas and new concepts going to come at on it, and we need to work on it. So if I not giving you that summary, but if I can summarize what I told you about, there are four or five major areas where, in my opinion, we need to take glaciology. If you really look at the history of glaciology, which I am associated for the last 30 years, in a smaller way contributing into the glaciological science in India, it has changed a lot. Because when I first decided to do the glacier inventory, I have to face a lot of difficulties. People thought glacier inventory is like measuring leaves on tree. So it's a useless exercise. But thanks to the climate change, and thanks to the more difficulty in strategically in other border of India, people have realized the importance of glaciers, because sometimes people thought that there are issues, strategic issues. So in my opinion, we have done a lot of things. And what are the things we did in last 30 years? If I remember when I first came back from Canada and started to work on glaciers, we have no idea how much glaciated area is there in Himalaya. Only one glacier was mapped for mass balance. There is no scientific group in country, in academics, glaciology. And there was no mechanism by which government of India can support any glacial research in this country. Things have changed dramatically. Today we are almost 10 academic institutions where there is a vibrant glaciological groups are there, they are working. We have around 10 glaciers where we have done mass balance. We already know now how much glaciated area in Himalayas. Our people are trained to undertake glacial work in a different facets of it. But what we need to do now is build on this and see that time has come for us to address real societal issues and real policy issues. Rather than, because we all are wonderful people, if I gave you a task and you say that you will get 100% credit for what you are going to do, you will work day and night. There is no problem on that. But I say that you 10 will work together and then we are all suspicious about it. So maybe now we have given up this hang up. We are trying to do that. Tomorrow you will listen more from Sanjay Rao on this, these issues. So, but these are the more areas where we need to do collectively work. Because no academic institution or any lab can do this work. Even if you take mass balance, no academic institution can do it for entire Himalayan mountain range. We need to standardize methods. We need to involve many groups. And we have to work together as a team. We are trying to do that in volume estimation. And we have succeeded in bringing at least 7-8 academic institutions, which really come together like IITs and JNUs and others, but we have literally, probably they have understood what we are trying to do. We are not undercut their efforts, but collectively build something more meaningful. So likewise, we require now major programs to do that. And I think conversion, last statement I would like to say is a conversion from small-scale glaciology to regional glaciology is probably required right now. And maybe some of you, when you go back to your academic institution, I'm sure we will continue to interact on those issues and see how collectively we can do meaningful work. That is, I think, is a future need of this, and which involves science as well as other things. With this, I would like to really thank all of you to, maybe tomorrow I will talk again, but I will not talk on science. I will more talk about thanking you, but I really thank you for taking time, coming from your distant places, all the way from Arunachal Pradesh to Bengaluru, which is not easy to come, and I appreciate, because it's the first batch which is so dedicatedly doing the work. Otherwise, it was very rare. I could meet many of them outside, very rarely inside. So thanks for doing it sincerely. And I hope this is some useful to you. Okay, thank you.